It's time for another Dice Tower review from Gamers Remorse.
Hello and welcome back to Gamers Remorse. Today, we check out the game Deadly Vacation, soon to be on Kickstarter. Let's check it out.
Deadly Vacation is a 2-10 player game by Medieval Lords, now on Kickstarter. Players will take on the roles of assassins on vacation attempting to survive while solidifying their position in the Assassin's Guild for yet another year. The game contains 3 playstyles. The main game, designed to play 5-10 players, but also has variants for a 2-player gang war and a 2-plus-player evidence hunt best suited with 3 or 4 players. For the sake of time, we will discuss the main game's rules. The game is set up with each player choosing their character and assembling the 2 target decks, composing the target cards for each of the active assassins. One of the target decks is set aside for later use. Starting with a randomly selected first player, each character will draw a target. If they draw themselves, the card is revealed and the new target is drawn before the character's card is returned to the deck. If this happens to one of the final 3 players to draw, all players will return their cards to the deck and repeat the process. Players will then set the miniature for their character on its designated start location, and the 2 policemen on the 2 blue locations. They will then set the health markers on the leftmost location on their health marker card, which, if it hits the skull, the character will die. Each player puts one of their cash tokens on the 5 cash locations, and are dealt 3 cards from the hidden action deck. Whenever a player walks over a hidden cash location they have not previously visited, they are given 2 more hidden action cards. Finally, the round marker is placed on the leftmost action on the round tracker, and play is ready to begin. On each turn, a character has 4 action points. They can use these action points to move. To move, the player must follow the lines connecting locations, each move costing 1 AP per location covered. They can trigger a direct or ranged kill for 1 AP, plant an activated or hidden action card. Planting the card is free, activating the card will cost the AP specified on the card. They can reveal a hidden item planted by another player at 1 action point per item they check. Not all items on all locations have to be checked, or they can disable a bomb or camera on their location for 2 action points. They are not required to spend all 4 action points, but extra action points will not carry over to future turns. Upon ending their turn, the player will move 1 of the 2 patrolmen 1 space. Each of the characters' need dials will then advance by 1. The assassins must monitor their needs as they run, kill, and plot. This is monitored by the 3 dials: Nature's Call, Hunger, and Rest. If the dial ever rotates beyond the highest value, the player will take a -1 point token and slide their health tokens 1 more space to the right, closer to the skull. If the character crosses a location with the restroom, food, or bed symbol, however, they will reset the corresponding dial back to 0, and they will not advance it at the end of this turn. On a character's first turn, they can never attempt to kill an opponent. This is always true for newly revived characters as well. After the character's first turn, they can kill their opponents. They can do so with direct kills, which are marked with the yellow icons on the playboard. To do so, both characters must be in the location, and the attacker must have 1 action point to spend on the kill. If the player has a knife or Garrett card, they can kill an opponent using the card on any location, regardless of whether there is a yellow symbol, as long as both players are in the same location. They can also commit ranged kills if they are in a location with a red icon, and their target is in a location connected to the icon by the dotted red line. When committing a ranged kill, you need to only worry about whether the target is in an exposed area. Exposed areas are marked by a white circle. The patrolman will also make an area exposed. If you ever kill a target in an exposed location, your assassin is caught and the kill is invalid, so the target will live. The loser will take a -1 point and become unprotected. If the area was exposed due to a security camera, the camera's controller gains 1 point. Once unprotected, a player may be killed by any other players, even in an exposed location, with no repercussion. In the instance, the killer would receive a bounty score of 1 point for killing the unprotected assassin. Players may also score through the following ways. 1 point when your target dies, regardless of how the target dies or who kills them. 1 point for killing your own target, meaning you would get 2 points for killing your target, as this would stack with the previous point. 1 point for the previously mentioned bounty score. Note, you can only kill an assassin who is not your target if they are unprotected. 1 point for catching a killer, as explained previously. 1 point for calling out your killer. This is done by ending your turn on the same spot as a patrolman, declaring who is targeting your assassin. If correct, their assassin is executed by law. If you call out the wrong killer, your assassin becomes unprotected and you lose 1 point. The turn after an assassin is killed, they will receive a -1 point token and return their miniature to the play area on any of the green locations. All characters returning this way have their protection restored, need dials reset at 0, and health marker returned to the top leftmost space. If your character was killed due to being called out as a killer, you will discard your target card and draw a new target from the previously set aside deck. The character cannot make a kill on their first turn after being such revived. After each player has played twice, a new round begins and the first player advances the round tracker by 1, and then each player will draw 2 new hidden action cards. Each assassin will then place one of their clue tokens on the bulletin board on a trait describing their target. Once the target is dead, the assassin targeting the player removes all their clue tokens from the bulletin board, discarding clearing their target and drawing a new target from the previously set aside target deck. The player will then immediately place one clue token on the bulletin board relating to their new target. Sometimes, the kill contracts will expire and all targets will be discarded. This happens when a total of 3 hits have been executed or the round token arrives and the final turn location. When this happens, all contracts are discarded, the 2 target decks are reassembled, the first player passes to the next player in clockwise order. Players will then repeat drawing new targets as they did during the initial setup. Play will continue until the kill contracts expire a second time or a player breaks a total of 5 points. When the game ends, the player with the highest score wins.
So usually what we do on Gamer's Remorse when we're doing a preview is we talk about one thing that each of us liked while playing the game. What did you think, Brian?
There were a lot of aspects of this game that I found quite interesting. I liked the modular nature of it. There is the standard game for 6 to 10 players, as well as a variant for 2 players and a variant for 3 to 5 players. So there's kind of 3 games in one. So I think that's kind of cool, getting to see how the components interact in different ways in different scenarios. Which was another thing I loved, are just the components. The miniatures are fantastic. They are gorgeous and painted and funny and cool.
That works.
I ran out of descriptive words. How about you guys? What did you guys like?
They're fun and cool. They remind me of a little bit like the Clue pieces, you know? The newer Clue pieces, not the old ones.
I don't have a new Clue pieces.
Oh, you're missing out.
He's clueless.
He's clueless. All right. What did I like about this game? I like that it was very much a party game that you had to think at least 2 to 3 steps ahead. Mm-hmm. So I guess I don't want to call it a party game like you would think Telestrations or Pictionary or any of those other games. It's more a large group game that's strategic. Bang would be something similar. Yeah. We had talked about that. I guess Werewolf would a little bit be like that, but that's more social. This is more reserved and antisocial because you don't want, there's a lot of metagaming. You don't want to tell everyone what your cards are. Yeah. Like most of those games. But this is a good strategic game, I would say, for 6 to 10 players. The variants are also good, but it's not, you know, the main game, I would say. Yeah. So this game was a lot of cat and mouse, but also chess-related movements to a degree. I thought that was very interesting and very unique. I hadn't seen many games try and accomplish a group-setting game that was this strategic. So I really liked that about it. What did you think, Eric?
It reminded me a lot of a video game I played quite a bit of, The Ship. Very same concept, and it was the board game aspect of the game, and it was very interesting to kind of see that come to life in a non-screen production type of game. So I really enjoyed it.
Yeah. The artwork is really good, the icons are good, and the illustrations are a lot of fun. Yeah.
Although
that out there.
I guess the one guy that was repainted or something.
There were some updates since ours. There was a character with a blue jacket that, and the final version of a black jacket, so as not to be confused with the constable.
Not that that's ever been done.
Oh. Yeah, about that. But I mean, it's a fun theme. There aren't a whole lot of games where you play as the assassins outside of, say, a Kill Doctor Lucky.
And this has some similarities there.
Mm-hmm.
In regards to, you don't want to be caught in the act killing, right? Mm-hmm. But at the same time, your whole reason is to do that. The variants kind of stray away from that, where you're more looking for clues.
Yeah.
You're also setting up traps for other assassins because you know there are some other ones at this.
There's almost a spy versus spy feel.
Oh, yeah.
In that. And then there's variable player powers, which is something I enjoy, as well as the cards, which add stuff beyond a lot of those whodunit or who's doing it games. So there's different ways of killing people and different aspects, even of using the map, so to speak, to kill people with a jet ski or the like.
If Hitman Holiday interests you, we recommend you check it out at MedievalLords.com. That'll take you right to their Kickstarter page.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff.
in stock. Check them out at coolstuffinc.com.